Welcome everybody. In this two-part workshop, yesterday we covered the basics of proofreading, why it is required, how much is the problem, how to solve it, and what are the standard markings used for proofreading, so that other people who correct the proof understand what we are trying to say. Then in second part yesterday, we also did an exercise, which was an artificial exercise just to illustrate all kinds of marks. The exercise was from the famous book, Chicago Manual of Style, which is in fact just called the Chicago. If somebody says the Chicago, that means Chicago Manual of Style, it's so famous. This manual was published in 1905 by Chicago University Press. And then because of public demand, they kept on expanding it and publishing new editions. Roughly every 10 years, they used to produce a new edition, which used to take into account changes that would have taken place in that decade in the language. The edition which is current is the 16th edition, which was published in 2010. So it's quite recent. And this takes into account all the modern media, including email, etc. So maybe in first session and or second session, we'll spend some time on how to use these rules while writing emails, etc. Since everybody has to write emails and respond to emails, we'll spend some time on that, guidelines for email. There is also a document which has been downloaded by Parag, which was originally published by Intel in 1995, when email had just started. That is about net etiquette, or netiquette, what they call. That when you are in the net, what kind of etiquette you have to observe. It's a long document, 16-page document, which you will put up on the site. But some important parts we'll review over here. So now today, that is 23rd March. Now we are going to concentrate on commas. The whole 2 hours will be on commas. Yesterday when we saw the correction marks, they were of three types. One were grammatical, the other were typographical, and third were punctuation marks. So punctuation marks we did not consider yesterday. This whole session will be only for punctuation marks. And 90% of punctuation marks are commas. So effectively the session will be on commas, plus some other like apostrophe, etc., we will consider in short, because they occur infrequently. So first, let's say, what is your impression of commas? Why are commas used? Or where do we use it intuitively, since you all use commas somewhere or the other? So why do we use commas at all? Semicolon is called ardhaviram. The full stop is called Purna Viram. Viram is stop. When you completely stop, when the sentence ends, we use a full stop. Semicolon is like a half stop, and comma is like a quarter stop, you can say. So that is right, that when you, if you vocalize the sentence and you feel that you should break it here, while speaking you would have broken it here, then you will put a comma there. If the meaning requires that you put a comma there, otherwise there will be ambiguity or misunderstanding, then we put a comma there. So first let us see what is the history of comma, how did it come into the language, how did it come into the script, and how it is related or unrelated to Indian scripts. Then we will understand why we have problems with commas. So originally this came at the time of Greeks, as an indicator of separator of sentence fragments. So the sentence fragments which were separated were called commas. Like in music, you use vertical lines to separate the number of beats, like 4 beats. After every 4 beats, you give a vertical line. That line is called a bar, which tells that one segment of music has ended. And the music between those two bars is also called a bar. Like if you have so much long music, they will say it is 32 bars of music. The interval itself is also called a bar. So here the equivalent of bar is a comma, that the separator between fragments of sentence or between words is called a comma. The original meaning was the fragment itself was called comma. That meaning is lost long back. And originally the grammatical meaning was not included in this. It was intuitive. Wherever you felt like breaking, like we do at present, you would put a comma saying that this is a fragment. There was no grammatical convention attached to that. Later on in European languages, the grammatical convention developed, because since anyway if you are pausing, you are giving a signal, like when we complete a sentence, we pause and give a full stop, which is a signal that one thought has been completed and the brain can process that part. Otherwise, till you give a clue, the brain will keep on thinking that something is coming and it will be disappointed. So we give a clue to the brain that one thought has ended, then it suddenly processes the whole thought, whole sentence at a time. Similarly, if the sentence has fragments which are by themselves meaningful as standalone, what we call clauses. In English, you might have learned clause analysis. That clause is a fragment of a sentence which can make a meaning by itself, and in a sentence you can substitute the whole clause by something else and see the whole sentence will be meaningful, because clause will behave as one unit. Like we have noun clause, adverbial clause, adjective clause, the whole clause behaves as if it is one word. In that case, we separate it by commas, because it is a meaningful fragment of a sentence, but the fragment is not a full sentence. It does not make a full statement. Any sentence must make a full statement. It does not make a full statement. So this meaning came later on. Originally, there used to be a lot of poetry in Greek drama, etc. And in poetry, you have to give breaks, that where you have to break the line for either meter or for breathing. So those were given by virgula, that is a slash, right word slash. Even today, if you see in Times of India editorials, etc., when they quote poetry, there are no commas or full stops used. They just go on putting these slashes. There it is understood that there the line has ended and next line. Then you can write the poetry continuously without writing one below another, one line below another. This is, even today, this is the convention for punctuating poetry. So that slash finally got shortened to a small symbol which we today have as the comma. That is the, it is a descendant of that original virgula. So then once comma was introduced, it was realized that it can be used to signal many things. Like even today you utilize that symbol, like comma separated lists. You use commas to say that this is a separate part and computer should treat it separately. Or in C language you use semicolon as end of a line every time you put semicolon, because we use it as a signal to the processor. So similarly, it started being used as a signal since it was available in many places. So the comma does not have a single use, it has multiple uses, and we will be studying all of them. We have made two A4 size tables, so we will go over them one by one, then we will hand over the copies to you also, so you can have a ready reference. This lists most of the normal uses of comma, so that you will never have a difficulty, because this is a classified table and you can, if you locate your item in that, you will always know where to use a comma or where not to use a comma. So you have a ready reckoner. Now why do we have problem with commas? So even today the understanding is that when you are speaking a long sentence, then you have to stop for breath, and wherever you stop for breath, you give a comma, which is symptomatically correct, that the comma corresponds to where you would have broken your breath. But why do you break the breath there and why not elsewhere? Why not one word before or one word later? Is it just related to how much breath you can hold? because then commas would have come at constant distance, because our breath capacity is fixed. But you will see that sometimes commas are after every word, sometimes they are after a long sentence. That means they are not, because we break breath. But there is a third reason, which is a master of both these. That third reason is, we are trying to signal meaningful parts of what we are talking, and where we want to signal that we break breath. Like we put a space between two words, and we take it for granted that there is actually a space between two words, because we want to signal that one word has ended and now the next word is starting. It is so natural that we take it for granted. But if you see old inscriptions or old stone inscriptions, etc., there were no breaks. They used to write continuously one letter after another. The reader had to figure out where the word is broken. From context, he had to make out. But now we have learned to give up space over there, so that reader is not confused and he can read fast. But if you observe an audio signal on oscilloscope, there is actually no break. While you are speaking, there is physically no measurable break over there. It is only perceived by us. So if you are counting meter and if you are counting the number of beats, the break should have taken one beat or something. But break is not counted as a beat, because there is no beat on that. It is only a visual clue. The actual break is so short, it is stolen out of the adjacent beat. There is no actual time break over there. So similarly, we have learned to use full stop to signal that a complete thought has ended. A sentence should have always have a complete thought. So comma is the next evolution in that. Now, if you see in Indian languages have no punctuation. Whether you are aware of this, I don't know. This has never been taught to us. In school, we have always been taught punctuation for our languages also. So we also have clause analysis and all equivalent things brought down into Indian languages. The original origin of most of Indian languages is Sanskrit. Sanskrit has only one punctuation mark, that is the vertibar, or what we call danda. One vertical line says that this sentence or whatever has ended. There is no other mark in Sanskrit. And the reason is that in Sanskrit, whatever you write is only pronounceable things. There are no non-pronounceable symbols in Sanskrit. While in Western script, there are many symbols which are not actually pronounced. They are visual clues to you. In Sanskrit, there are no such clues. This vertibar is still followed in Hindi, since all of you have learnt Hindi. In Hindi, when we complete a sentence, we put a vertibar or danda. We don't put full stop. India has followed the same convention. There are no commas or semicolons or anything else in Indian languages. We have all learnt it during British rule, and we have tried to copy them without understanding why they use it. That's why we are confused. If you see carefully, even from the script, you can make out that these symbols don't belong here. Like if you see Devanagari script, it can be written by a flattened pen. The thickness and thinness that you see in the script entirely comes from using of that pen. But if you see comma and other symbols like question mark, they cannot be written by that pen. They have been artificially made up to look like English symbols. They cannot be written by the bamboo pen that you use or quill that you use. You can't write those symbols with that, because they are Western symbols. So how do Indian languages manage without commas? What is your guess? So if it were important, they would have invented it. The answer is, Indian language construction is such that you don't have to use commas. The flow of the sentence is such that you don't have to signal anything in between. The sentence will always make a meaning when you end the sentence, howsoever long the sentence is. This is why no commas are required. In English especially, compared to any other European languages, English is a syntactic language. Means it uses syntax for giving meaning. Words themselves may not have meaning. Like they don't have vibhaktis like we have. We have vibhakti pratyay, like ablative case or vocative case, etc. We attach suffixes to each word, and then the word becomes self-sufficient. Wherever you place in the sentence, you will always find its correct relation. But in English, there are prefix words like of, for, which indicate vibhakti. And because of that, the sentence structure gets twisted, and then wrong meaning can occur because there is no suffix, and the word comes and some next word comes, and you can get confused. That's why English cannot manage without commas. There may be other European languages which are, this is, our languages are called paradigmatic, that they use paradigm or formation of words, and then you can use the word freely in the sentence. First, you have to make effort. In English, the first effort is negligible. You just learn the words and you are launched. But later on, you suffer for a lifetime because you have to always manage the word sequence to be correct, which in our language, you don't have. Even if you twist the whole sentence, the meaning will come out in any Indian language. So that's why we don't have this problem in our language. But in English, one has to be very careful. So this is why we have to use commas. And once they have been available, they have been used in many places. That's why we have to learn all the places where they are used and try to use them correctly. This is the background of commas. Any questions anybody has? This must be a news to most people that Indian language has no punctuation. If you see old documents, there are no punctuations. Only after the British came, you find that everything was copied. In fact, they were so enamored by the English language that like you have capital and small in Roman script, people tried to use capital and small letters for Indian scripts also initially. Then they gave up that it is not required for Indian script because small letters were only short forms or simpler forms of capital letters, and our letters are already simplified. We don't need two forms of them. This was actually prepared in 2002, if you see the date below. Because our humanities department runs a centralized course, HS699, and I used to take these four lectures in that course. So this was prepared as a course material for that. So this is divided into two pages. If you see the first column, then elements are the two parts which you are trying to separate with a comma. And their rank can be equal rank, that is whole first page, and unequal rank, that is second page. So there are two main types of commas used. Commas between elements of equal rank, because element can be a word, it can be a clause, or it can be a phrase. So then let's see the second column, that is conditionality. Here it says again the first group of first three rows is unconditional, means it is syntactic. Whatever is the content of the element is immaterial. We are not interested in meaning of that. It is only because that element happens to be there and it is of that type of element that this comma has to be used. It is compulsory. We don't have to look at the meaning. So this is actually the simplest meaning of commas, which is unrelated to the actual meaning of the element you are separating. So number of elements can be greater than or equal to 2. Means whether you have 2 elements or more elements, the same rule applies. Some rules will be for only 2 elements, that is between pairs, and some rules will involve more than 2 elements. So this rule applies to more than 2 elements. The type of element in all the cases in first row is words. They are words. Those circles mark means they are worlds. So, firstly, name and title. You can make out that the context is IIT from the examples used. So, Professor Isaac, who was Dr. Phatak's teacher while he was doing his M.Tech and Ph.D., comma Ph.D. will visit, because Professor Isaac is his name and Ph.D. is his degree or title. Will visit. Now the dot after Ph and D also seems to be optional. In many places it is being dropped. You just write P small h and D. For all degrees, it is being dropped. Secondly, address. See, this is also important, because whatever email or anything you prepare, you will have to write name, address, etc. If nothing else, even if the email has no content, it will have a header which will have all this, and it should always follow this convention. So, address is Cresit, comma IIT Powai, comma Mumbai 76. So, each element of the address, because it will be say house number, street number, locality, each of these are separate elements, they are of separate geographical types. So if there is no comma, then all of that will be taken as the name of one locality or one element. To signal that we are jumping levels, that one is a house number, one is a building number, flat number, then street number, we give commas. Let we go on jumping to higher and higher levels till finally comes the pin code. In fact, this is the reverse of how address should be given, but since this is a convention, we can't help it. In fact, the like most significant digit, we should give the pin code first for sorting, but for sorting we have to go to the end, watch the pin code and then sort backwards. But this is the convention here. In Germany etc., the address is given in reverse and your flat number comes last. The equivalent pin code or zip code comes first. The postman only looks at the first code and sorts. The next sorter looks only at the second word and sorts. Till the final postman will only look at the flat number and delivery. Then geographical names, which are like addresses, but there will be city, state, nation, etc., and they have to be separated. So Cresit is in Mumbai, comma India. Then date. The first three parts were places, and now we come to dates. So in dates, August 15, comma 1947. If we don't give a comma, the 15 can get mixed up with 1947. It can be either read as 15-1947 or any combination depending on how people perceive it. So to avoid that, we have to give a comma, that the date has ended and next is year. But if the numbers are not next to each other, no comma, you see the last column shows a counter example, that if you write 26 January, it can be 26th January also if required, 1950. Now there is no comma required, because you can't confuse between 26 and January. You know, one is a number, the other is the name of a one, and the last is a number which signifies year, because we are giving going on increasing the time scale. Here no comma should be used. If the flow is like this, that there is no ambiguity, then no comma should be used. Incidentally, these two dates are very important for India, as you know. We have intentionally taken those dates as examples. Then last is numbers. So in numbers, we have to separate out numbers depending on grouping. Like in India, we have first three digits will be hundreds, tens and units. Then left to that will be 1,000 and 10,000. Next to that will be what we call lakhs, which is 100,000. So if we are writing for an Indian audience, and we are using crores, lakhs, etc., then we have to give commas like this. But in Western and worldwide, the comma comes after every 3 digits because their number system goes in multiples of 3. Like after 1000 will come million, then will come billion. Like we have megabyte, gigabytes. But after every 3, you have to give a comma. Otherwise, if there is a long list of numbers, people can't make out. You cannot often make out whether it is really the most significant digit is million or not. That's why you should give a comma. And we use the other punctuation marks, that is full stop, as a decimal point, isn't it? It is used in mathematics, it is the same symbol used as a decimal point. In fact, that is actually a bit confusing because it can get lost and then the whole number will become 100 times. So in Germany or maybe whole of Europe, they use comma as a decimal point because that cannot be mistaken. And these separators are dots. What we call decimal points are used in these places to separate millions, thousands, etc. But decimal point is indicated by a comma because it cannot get lost. No comma. That is, PIN is not supposed to have a comma. Otherwise, you would have comma after 4,00,00 and 076. But PIN is not a number. PIN is a code which happens to use numerals. It is not to be treated as a number. It is only a code. So there should be no comma anywhere in a PIN. Next, we come to second row in this, which is coordinating. The reference type is, everything else is same, it is between equal elements and it is unconditional and it is between coordinating conjunctions. So this will be between clauses, all the markings are for clauses. So the examples are, these are the coordinating conjunctions, that is and, but, or, nor, for, so, and yet. These are the coordinating conjunctions. For each of them, we have an example. Buy now and pay later. If you are writing colloquially, you can just write buy now, comma, pay later. The and is understood over there. But for clarity, it is better to put and. Then next is but. Many are called, but few are chosen. This is a famous maxim. Here also, if the context is understood or for rhetorical effect, you can drop the but. From context, people will make out that many are called, but few are chosen. But since we are not authors, or we are not writing literature, we are writing technical script, so we should be unambiguous. Here why but is used, because and also could have been used. So the but is indicated for contrast. Many are called, so we would expect many are chosen, but many are not chosen. So but signals that there is a contrast in what is coming next. And if the sentence is longer, then this comma is replaced by a semicolon. If the first part of the sentence, long sentence, and second part are contrasting to each other, then instead of a comma, we use a semicolon. Third coordinating conjunction is or. To be or not to be, this is a famous sentence of Hamlet, you must be knowing. So this is a disjunction because either it is to be or it is not to be. Fourth is nor. He did not attend, nor did he study. This obviously refers to a student. So he could have been spared if he had studied by not attending. So nor indicate that neither he did this nor he did that. If the sentence is short, then you don't have to use neither to start with. If the sentence is long, then you have to signal at the beginning by neither that you look for nor somewhere else. But since this is a short sentence, you need not use neither. Next is for. He gained nothing, comma, for he reached nothing. Here, what does for mean? It is not the usual meaning of for here. Here, for means because he reached nothing, he gained nothing. But if we had used because over here, the sentence would have become too long. And this coordinating conjunction would have been too heavy. So this is another meaning of for. Then so, he reached nothing, comma, so he gained nothing. This is the same sentence inverted. Here it is showing the result instead of explaining the reason. It is first giving the reason, and because of this, he gained nothing. So is actually therefore. Here, but so indicates the meaning of therefore. Last is yet. He studied hard, yet he failed. Here again, yet like the but before is indicating contrast. Because if he had studied hard, you would have expected that he would have passed. But he did not pass. So this yet is a stronger form of that but. That despite studying hard, he failed. So these are where they are used in along with coordinating conjunctions. Then the third row is when they are used, elements are used in series. In the previous row, the count was 2. It is always used between 2 clauses. If there are more than 2 clauses, you have to again identify between each pair of clauses whether comma is applicable. But this is a binary use. Here the number of elements has to be greater than or equal to 3. If there are less than 3 elements, then this use doesn't apply, as we will see. So series are of two types, A comma B and C, and A comma B or C. So this is a bit controversial thing. Many people will think that before the and or no comma is required. They will write A comma B and C or A comma B or C. But this has been debated in all the references, including Chicago Manual, Oxford University Press, Harvard University Press. So this use of comma is called Oxford comma in Britain, because Oxford University recommends that this comma should be used. In the US, Harvard University insists that this comma must be used. So it is called a Harvard comma. And we'll see why it is required, though we can manage without that. So this series A, B and C are like mathematical variables. A, B and C can be clauses, they can be phrases, or they can be words. In all the cases, this is applicable. Most of the time, we will encounter it between words. But even between phrases and between clauses, the same rule applies. So, first is a complicated example, clauses. U is understood. Start early, comma, drive cautiously, comma, and reach safely. This is a sign you will find when the ghat starts or used to start, because now the highway doesn't have this sign. But in the old Bombay Pune Road, this sign used to be there. That start early, drive cautiously and reach safely. Now these are three clauses. The start early is one clause, drive cautiously is second, you is understood everywhere and reach safely. Now because there are three clauses of equal rank, before the and, this forward comma must be there. This most people will otherwise miss. Then the next is called absolute praises. His paper folded, his pen closed, comma, and his eyes shut. These three are clauses of similar type. So they are describing about that person, comma, he sat patiently. So all these first three are having related meaning. So since these three are clauses, that is elements of similar type, again that and is required. Then predicates, we need not bother about the grammatical meaning of this. He could buy food, pay the bills, comma, and invest in the bank. So this is all related to he could. The predicates are about he could. So he could buy food, pay the bills, and invest in the bank. So again before and there is a comma. Last is the simplest and which you will be encountering most often is between words. So between nouns or pronouns. So comma, comma, semicolon, comma and full stop are punctuation marks. This is referring to itself, it is referring to grammar. Since there are three of them, comma, semicolons and full stop, that is why there is a comma before the and. Verbs, he read, planned and wrote. So again there are three verbs with the same subject. So again there is a comma before the and. In fact in older language, I was like Veni Vidi Vici, I came, I saw, I conquered. It does not say and I conquered. But in modern language we have to use and. Here there are no counter indications that you cannot escape this comma. If these conditions are satisfied, so there is a cross here, you always have to use the comma. Last is between adverbs. Write effortlessly, comma, systematically, comma, and correctly. So these are all different adverbs for the verb write. They are not related to each other, the adverbs. Like effortlessness is not related to systematicness. They could be independent. And correctness could not be related, may not be related to either of the two. Since they are independent adverbs, you have to put comma. If you don't put a comma, you read the counter indication. He worked absolutely systematically. Now, if you write, he worked absolutely, comma, systematically, it will not make any meaning. Because absolutely related to systematically. Absolutely has no independent existence. So here we can clarify what is an adverb, can anybody tell me? Now like adjectives qualifies a noun, it is called qualifies a noun, and an adverb modifies a verb, the technical term is modifies a verb. So that is a part definition of adverb. Adverb is which modifies a verb or an adjective or another adverb. So here this adverb is modifying the second adverb, so it is still called an adverb. It absolutely is not modifying any verb, it is modifying another object, another adverb which is modifying the verb. So all these three are called adverbs. Though we are taught only first meaning, that is modifying the verb, but modifying an object, adjective is also called an adverb. Like if you say he is very intelligent, then very is an adjective of intelligent, which is also an adjective. So the very is now adverb in this place, because it is modifying another adjective, it is not qualifying a noun. So with this we finish the unconditional use of commas. Now we will dwell on why this comma is required. So suppose you have a long list like A, B, C, D, E, F and G. Then when you say A comma B comma C, you have no clue what is the relation between A and G, whether it is A and B or it is A and B and C or A or B or C. Before the last item you declare that it is AND or and then you understand that all the previous commas actually stood for AND or. If you don't put this, then A, B, comma, C and D. So C and D will form one unit, but this AND will not be applicable to the whole list. So you will be, you won't know what is the relation. It could be A or B also. The comma could mean anything. So the comma before the last AND or last OR indicate the whole list which might have any number of elements before. They were all ANDs and all ANDs or ORs have been substituted by commas. Instead of writing A and B and C and D, we just write A comma B comma etc. and just before the last element we declare AND or. Then it is applicable. This is a short form. That is why this comma is essential. Otherwise it can in some situations lead to ambiguity. That is why all the universities insisted. And this as it is given is applicable to only 3 or more elements. If you have 2 elements, suppose A and B, do you put a comma or not? You do not put a comma. So this is greater than or equal to 3 elements. If there are 2 elements, then there is no comma required because it is exactly between those 2 elements. So there it should be given as counter example that there comma should not be put. Between any 2 elements, no comma should be put. So we have finished equal elements and unconditional or syntactic use. Here we need not even know the detailed meaning of what we are writing. But still just by the structure, these commas have to be used. The second type of comma, that is between coordinating conjunctions, you will rarely face. The first part, that is geographical locations, dates and these you will frequently need, and lists you will frequently need, especially in technical documents. There will be lot of lists of various items. There you should always use this comma. So this first and third row are important for us. Then the second group of commas between equal elements, there is a double line here as a separator, and these are conditional commas or semantic commas. Conditional because you have to observe the meaning and then decide where to use a comma. Even though the structure looks that it requires a comma, that structure alone is not enough. So reference type is between adjectives. Now you forget the technical words here. We will just see the example, that is between words. So accurate comma detailed analysis is found in some ancient Indian books. So this is accurate analysis and detailed analysis. The comma says that this is it's like having a bracket, and when you open the bracket it gets multiplied by both the elements. So these adjectives individually apply to the noun. That is why there is a comma. They are not related to each other. And separate examples is rhodium is a hard comma white metal. It is a hard metal and it is a white metal. Both these things are independent. It could have been soft and white, or it could have been hard and black also. They are orthogonal to each other. That is why there is a comma, that instead of writing it is a hard metal and it is a white metal, like children would have done that way, that they would have written everything twice, but we take a shortcut, give comma between adjectives and write the noun last. So the comma indicates that you have shortened the sentence. Now cumulative means the meaning is built upon each other. Rhodium is a hard white metal, comma, while silver is a soft white metal. Now here hard and white are together because they are both together qualifying rhodium. So here we should not use a comma because we are contrasting between hard white metal and soft white metal. So here comma should not be used. This is a bit technical, probably we won't have to face such situation. Then last among these is to prevent misreading. If meaning is ambiguous, then you should use a comma to clear the ambiguity. If meaning is unambiguous, then you should not use a comma. So otherwise, the person will start thinking whether there is some other meaning involved while the meaning is clear. So this arises because of word order. If we change the word order, you can make commas vanish. To Amar, comma Joshi was a puzzle. Now, if you don't give a comma, then it will become Amar Joshi, and you won't know what is a puzzle to whom. So there is only one person described, Amar Joshi. Here, two persons are being described. That is, Amar is puzzled by Joshi. Joshi is the object of that, and Amar is the subject. So here, comma is required. Same sentence can be reconfigured. Joshi was a puzzle to Amar. Then there is no comma required and there is no ambiguity. But sometimes for rhetorical effect, you want to use the first type. Then you should be prepared to use a comma. Because if you are describing about Amar, then you would put Amar first in the sentence. That's what has happened in the first sentence. And Joshi was a puzzle is next. People who can, comma, write correctly. Means people who can write, do it correctly. That is the meaning. So this expanded sentence, people who can write correctly are rare. Because now people who can write correctly has itself become, there is suspense. You have to say something about this. So this is a noun clause. You have to say something about it. You have to have a predicate to this subject. So comma are rare, but within the first part there is no comma. So this kind of comma you can avoid by rephrasing the sentence. And in technical document, it is better to rephrase a sentence and use a straight construction. So then it is unambiguous. Okay, so here we have finished off almost half of the uses of comma. So second page we are not going to spend as much time. You can read on your own. It's highly technical regarding grammar, and in the kind of writing that we do or editing, we won't need most of the things. So this you only carry as a reference. We'll take only one of the five rows for consideration. So that is a central row, that is conditional or semantic, introductory. So it refers to introductory clause or introductory prepositional phrase or introductory verbal phrase. We need not see the technical meaning because from the examples it will be clear what it means. So let us take introductory clause. If it's a long introductory clause, so the example is when we write for an educated reader, we should use commas properly. So after the first half, that is after reader, there is a comma, because when we write for an educated reader is an introductory phrase to the remaining sentence, that we should use commas properly. So whenever such introductory phrase is there and it is long, because the reader won't know where the introductory phrase has ended and where the main body of the sentence has started. So to signal the reader that the introductory phrase has ended, now the main sentence starts, there should be a comma. And if the introductory phrase is short, then optionally you can eliminate comma. So when we write, you could have given a comma here, we should use commas properly. Here the introductory phrase is when we write, which is so short that you may or may not give a comma there. But if it is long, then you should give a comma. So that is to help the reader where to break the sentence. The next is prepositional phrase. As per grammar is a standalone part. Commas have different uses, because commas have different uses, the previous part could have been anything else. These two are separate sentence fragments, so to separate them we should use a comma. And third is called a verbal phrase, having decided to use commas, because having decided means the whole thing is referring to an action, that we have decided something, we should use them properly. And the long form of that is, having decided to use commas obliges us to use them properly. So here now there is no comma required, because you have joined it to the next part of the sentence. In the first part this is understood, that having decided implies this. So this is the only thing that we will consider in the class. Remaining is for your reference. You can go through the examples, and if you need any of those, then you can use that. For now we will be doing some exercises. I will explain to you what the exercise is. We will take about 3 pages as is, means it has come for proofreading, you can say. We will take those as our exercise. Maybe we will take some pages in that. In that the content is small, because there are photographs and tables. But this is a published document. So we will see in a published document how many errors are there, and in a proof ready document also how many errors. It looks from this draft that this is not a proof, this is more like a manuscript, because in some places you would feel like making changes in the content, etc. Therefore some changes might be controversial. We presume that it's a manuscript, that we still have to talk to the author and decide, but we will point out wherever we feel that there should be change. So we start from the first page. Social media has invaded all aspects of our life. Now media is a plural word. The medium is the singular, and media is the Latin plural of that. And it is really meant they are multiple media, because they are independent of it. So it should be social media have invaded. Social media have invaded all aspects of our life. Convergence of exponentially growing technologies of computing, internet, comma, and wireless phones. This is our serial comma or Harvard comma. This is the first example. Have created entirely new groundbreaking opportunities. Now groundbreaking, there should be a hyphen, or it should be one word, but hyphen is better, so it's easier to read. Then all modern businesses are forced to recognize and equip themselves. So forced to recognize what? So we should say this means whatever the previous sentences said, that this media convergence, etc. So there should be this after recognize. And after this there should be a comma. So now we are joining two clauses. And equip themselves to operate and benefit from this new business reality. The operate part I haven't understood, but I'll leave it to the author what it means operate over here. Then we recognize that our management education will be incomplete without the knowledge of this new business environment. Now our means whose? Because this is a management institute writing. So is it education of the management, or the education which they are carrying out? So they should, though this is understood, they should spell out that of our institute or some such thing. Last year we decided to add a course in PGTM program to help students gain knowledge and hands-on practical skills of this new environment. We started the search for a comprehensive textbook to teach this subject, comma, and soon realized that the first part is a separate clause, and soon realized there was no good textbook available. So it should be realized that, comma, there was no good textbook available. Now, good as an adjective indicates that you are running out of options. It is like children writing that they will say everything is nice, because they don't have discrimination of many adjectives. So the adjective good doesn't really signify anything, that except that it is positive. The word here might be suitable or appropriate textbook available. There was where? Yeah, yeah, we started with, now we are talking in that sense. When they started, everything is being described in the past. When they searched, there was no textbook available. Yeah, there was no textbook. No textbook means not a single one. No textbook means not a single one. That's why it is singular. That's why it is was. Not even one was available. If they had said there were no textbooks available, then it is there. But there is not a single one, that's why they had, even if there was one, then they wouldn't have written this. That's what they mean. When we read further, we'll see that they had to write the textbook themselves because there was not a single one available. That's why it is was. So suitable or appropriate textbook available in the market. Now, but now your objection comes. The sentence should never start with a but. It's like children who complete a sentence and they realize that they have forgotten something. So they say, but ma, and then they will add to that, to their explanation. Similarly, starting with and or starting with any preposition is ruled out in standard writing. Only authors can do it for dramatic effect. But otherwise, you should join the sentence. So here, instead of but waiting, it's better to say however. Waiting for a textbook to introduce this course was not an option. So it will be book available in the market, comma, however, comma, waiting for a textbook for this to introduce this course was not an option. So first para is complete. Now second para starts. We prepared the course outline. Now this has to join to the first para. This is starting somewhere where we don't know why they did this. So it should be therefore. Therefore we prepared the course outline with this previous explanation that not a single textbook was available. Therefore we prepared the course outline, identified the web services for student practical sessions, reference books, comma, this is our serial comma again, because there is a long list, reference books and enormous amount, next page, of online resources. We were getting the first-hand experience of how the new social media world had changed, comma, and textbooks have become obsolete. How the new social media world had changed, comma, and textbooks have become obsolete. The most up-to-date knowledge is this in is redundant here, because in doesn't signify anything, is now available. Yeah, up-to-date should be hyphenated. Available in blogs, wikis, yeah, comma, and news feeds, or if the list is not limited to these, which it may not be, then news feeds, comma, etc. because there can be other media. These are just three examples. Now, when you write etc., do you have to give comma before etc.? You have to give a comma. This part of the serial comma, because etc. means et means and, cetera means others. So and others, etc. is a and etc. dot is a short form for and others. So because there is and followed by others, there has to be a comma. So before etc. there is always a comma. But while teaching other subjects, this is the new reality. But while teaching other subjects, comma, so there is an introductory clause. We do not face this reality as much as we did in this course on collaboration technologies, full stop. We realize that our students will have to depend more on learning from these internet resources than the printed textbooks. This is a bit, they will have to depend more than on the printed textbook. If it says more on learning from this, then depending on printed textbooks or on learning from printed textbooks. But this we can leave if the meaning is understood. But before than, there should be a comma. Because the than refers to depend. The end result was our decision to ask our students to learn from the internet resources, comma, and present their learning in the form of social media outputs. We also wanted to capture learning of our students of first class for the benefit of following classes. Here class is ambiguous because we don't know whether it's a single class. What they probably mean here is a batch. No, so first batch, because we don't know which year this is. It could be second year of their PGDA, second year student doing this project. So first batch of students, first batch for the benefit of following batches. So later on they said there are 240 students, it cannot be one class, it has to be one batch. So batch and batches. The students did a great job of researching and learning from various internet resources as well as from whatever was available in the form of books. So after resources there has to be a comma, because that as well as is for researching and learning from whatever was available in the form of books. A group of 240 students was real heavy power. They have worked together, comma, tirelessly. This comma should be removed, because worked together and tirelessly are not independent. They have worked together and worked tirelessly. These are all related. So worked together tirelessly in a very systematic collaborative way. This book is the result of collaboration of 240 students and the BIMTEC faculty members. In a collaborative activity, it is difficult to name any few individuals for the success. This any few is not a good construction. They should say selected individuals or only few. You have to name all of them if all of them are doing work. So to name only few or selected individuals for the success. Every one of the 240 students had a role to play, comma, and deserves full recognition, because recognition is subsequent to having work. So that is at present. Yes, everyone is one word, you are right. Everyone is one word. A group photo and names of students. Here it should say names of the corresponding students, because there are various groups. So group photo and names of corresponding students who are in the group photo are added to each chapter of this book, comma, which was the result of their collaborative endeavor. Because this which refers to chapter, whichever group is selected, they had wrote one chapter. Then this book is also accompanied by the online blogs, wikis, comma, and sites maintained by the authors of this book. These online resources will provide the readers of this book continuous updates on the progress and trends. Actually, this should be transposed. These online resources will provide continuous updates on the progress and trends to the readers of this book. This should be transposed for clarity. Last page. It is not necessary to read this book from beginning to end. It should be a reader can start anywhere at any topic of interest, because multiple readers will have multiple topics of interest. So it should be in singular. So A capital. A reader can start anywhere at any topic of interest. This has resulted in some duplication, comma, but the duplication is worth the benefit. In fact, it should be it is worth the benefit. But since they are talking about duplication, they have put duplication in duplicate. Finally, all readers are urged to send their comments, suggestions for improvement, errors observed, comma, this is serial or comma, or just share with us any thoughts. We hope you enjoy reading, learning, comma, and successful implementation at work of this collaboration technology. Now, when I had read, I had about 38 errors, and plus during discussion the participants have added at least 6 or 7 errors. So there are about 45 errors. So as I said, we should treat this as a manuscript. That's why justification errors we are not correcting here, because the formatting will take place later on. At that time we can dictate that it should be right left justified. So those errors we are not taking, but typography with capital and small, yes, it has to be corrected at this stage. Okay, so this has given you a taste of what real editing will be like. Even if we create documents, they will start life somewhat like this. The first draft after printing out, and you can see the statistics that over three pages they must have gone through this before printing this out. Still there are at least 40 errors where the actual content is 2 pages, including photographs and other things, but in 2 pages there are 40 errors. So after this first pass, they will reduce to only few, because there will be contentious points about grammar, but otherwise the errors will almost vanish after one pass. Some hints about internet and what we do further after this class ends, what procedure we adopt and how we utilize this knowledge in our day-to-day work. So first part is, Parag had requested that many people have a query whether there are any specific guidelines for internet. So for internet, besides technicalities of internet which you have to observe, the basic principle is that you have to assume whatever is on the internet, whether sent through any any means, is not secure. Even though it will give an impression of it being person to person or whatever, it is less secure than any other medium. It is archived in many places, and you have to assume that it is in the public domain. So whatever you would not write on a postcard and drop it in a postbox, don't write on internet. If it is so open that you can write on a postcard and anybody can read on the way, then only you put it on the internet. Otherwise, internet is not a secure media. This has to be always kept in mind. That means you have to take it seriously while writing anything on internet, whether it is friendly, whether it's offensive. You have to assume that it will be read by many people and it will last forever. It will be archived forever. So you should be able to own it up, whatever you write on the internet later on. So instead of hurriedly writing something, you should always keep etiquette in mind. There should be a gentlemanly etiquette always in internet, even if it is your friend. Secondly, as we have discussed, that if you are publishing anything in any medium, it has to be to the same standard. So you assume that your email will be printed and distributed. It has to be like any other printed letter or any other printed document. It should have the same standard of editing. So that will distinguish your emails from anybody else's emails, because most of the other people are careless about emails. They assume it is just like draft or some such thing. It should not be treated as a draft. You first draft it, don't send it online or something. First compose it, read it properly, correct it, and then only send it. And if it's a contentious email where the other party is likely to misconceive or something, or you might make an error while writing, then you should compose it today, sleep overnight, and tomorrow morning you check whether what you have written is okay. If you still find it is worth sending, then only you send it. Don't send immediately. Maybe you will have second thoughts about that. So this is about all, which is a basic guideline for email. Email is far easier to send, and that is a trouble, because you can make mistakes, and before you realize, the mistake goes out. So we should not be in a hurry to send, like we should not be in a hurry to print the final version of any document till it is corrected. Only after it is ready for printing, like, then only you send the email. This will keep your emails distinct from many other people's emails, because many other people are casual about emails. So whatever applies to any written document, that you shouldn't use short forms without first defining them, etc. You shouldn't use colloquialisms. It should be written in or proper English. It should be proper English. It should not be colloquial English. This is about guidelines for internet. Next is now how to utilize this knowledge. Now, I don't know what each person or each section is doing. At some point in your work, you will be coming across a document. Either you will be composing the documents. If you are not, then you may be checking the documents, even if you are not writing the document. So in each section, you should form a group of people and take turns in checking anything that goes out. So the first rule we have seen is that any first proof should be treated as a manuscript, so it should be double spaced. First time you print out any document, it should be double spaced. Then you give it to a colleague or somebody. First you check yourself, then give it to a colleague and ask the colleague to check. After those errors are removed, you again, if now you assume that the errors will be few, now you can print in single space and give it to another colleague who has not seen this document. Then that person will be able to find some more errors, etc. So this you can do 3 or 4 times, because the next person will take very short time to read. The document will be easy to read after removing the first error, but maybe some few errors which are mistaken, or everybody has a different focus, they will still be found. And only after everybody in your section has cleared, then you finalize it for printing. So if we follow this collaborative process, then all of us can improve our standard, because when somebody else finds your mistakes, then you come to know, and then you record it in your mind that you don't make the same kind of mistake again. This happens to everybody and everybody's understanding of rules goes up. And then you will have a pool of people in each section who can, anyone can take that and correct it. There won't be a specialized person like a proofreader. Most other people will be able to do preliminary proofreading. Maybe some who are more competent, they can take a last look at that just before it goes for printing. The most competent person should take a last look at that. They shouldn't take the first look. First look should be taken by somebody who is not so experienced and remove all the errors, then the remaining errors will come up. So if you follow this procedure, in the olden days when it was typeset, there used to be two proofreaders. So one used to read out from this, including comma, semicolon, all unpronounced things. He used to read out small cap, large cap, etc. And the other person used to just check. Then after a page, they used to take turns that the other person would read and this person would check. That is how proofreading always works. The person who composed the matter would not do the proofreading. It would be second and third person. So now same procedure we have to follow. So that is about all. If you have anything to ask or say, you are welcome. So with that, I will say thank you and goodbye.